Hey guys, and welcome to another episode of Behind the Closed Doors. Today, the workshop, Smoke and Props with Lois. And today it's all about smoke and, well, props. So join us for today's episode. If you like what we do, subscribe, a like, and if you don't like, hit that not like button twice. You got that one? Let's go. Okay, so today the workshop Smoke and Props with Lois. And today we are using smoke machines because it's a smoke workshop, right? Sounds obvious. So what kind of smoke machine do you have to buy if you want to do the same stuff as this? In essence, there are two different smoke machines. There are more, but in essence two. Oil-based and water-based. Now, oil-based warms up very, very fast and gives you a nice stream of smoke. Water-based, you need to warm up for, let's say, 5 or 10 minutes, depending on how cold it is in or outside. And, well, after about 2 or 3 minutes, you have to warm up again. That's why we actually use two machines. So you might wonder, Frank, why don't you buy an oil machine? Well, very simple. Think about this. Every time you use a smoke machine, it also ends up in your strobes, right? Because it goes through your strobes via the fans. If you use an oil-based machine, it's a little bit like a smoker. There will be some nicotine in your lungs, right? And at the end, it will absolutely kill you. Probably. Eventually. So, all that oil going through your strobes isn't good. Now, when you use a water-based machine, the only thing that goes through your strobe is actually water vapor. And that already goes through your strobe every single day because we have that in our air. So an oil-based machine is really bad for your strobes. A water-based machine isn't that bad for your strobe. I'm not going to tell you it doesn't impact your life at all, but I don't think you will ever notice it because otherwise our strobes would have been dead by long now because we use a lot of smoke in some of our workshops and some of my photo shoots. So today, two smoke machines, our model Lois, and of course some cool props and sets. And we're going to use a new sofa that we actually got this week. So that's going to be interesting in our new set also. And of course, today we're shooting with the A7R IV. And we have something else in the mail that's really nice for all you calibrator fans out there. Now, as you know, I'm a huge fan of using color checkers, light meters, and of course, calibrating your monitor for the very simple reason you have to make sure that what you shoot is also what you see on your monitor, right? Because otherwise, if you shoot something, you edit it, and then you print it, or you show it to a client on all different displays, you will get results where you go like, this isn't right. Now, of course, if your client doesn't calibrate the monitor, well, you might say, why should I? Well, the answer is very, very simple. He is used to that monitor. And let's hope that other professional photographers do use calibration tools. So he is used to how his monitor looks. So everything will look normal for him if you calibrate. If you don't calibrate, it might be that your images look slightly different from the other ones, and that will lose you a gig, or your client will actually complain. So there's no reason to not calibrate. Now, the brand I always use is X-Ray. Right, and this is the new one. This is the iDisplay Pro Plus, and they have a whole new range. There are 3 new analyzers, and I will make a blog post and video about that very, very soon after we've done some initial testing. Because I've been using X-Rite products for years, I highly recommend them. And this is a new series, and again, I'm not somebody that tests something 5 minutes and then tells you guys it's awesome to find out after before, for example, 2 weeks that it isn't. So I take some time to test out stuff, but very, very soon you will see a blog post about what analyzer to buy, and a little bit in the vlog or maybe also in the written blog about what these analyzers do for you guys. So the students are already coming in. Let's do a little Q&A to start our workshop with, and then we're going to do some shoots with the new A7R IV from Sony with Lois, and of course smoke and props. Okay, set number one. We are using the Hensel lighting and our stage and, well, the sofa we got. That's a new sofa and we are still trying to figure out what to do with it. Maybe make it a really, like an urbex look, destroy it in other words, or just keep it like this. So let me know in the comments below how you would like to see this sofa, because this one is open for anything. You can do whatever you want with it. So leave comments below, let me know what you like to see. The setup. One light on our model Lois, and one light was actually placed behind the sofa with a gel. We just used some smoke, and at that point you will see that smoke acts as a diffuser, a reflector, but also can literally just take light away. It's very unpredictable, it's literally a little bit hard to steer, but overall when you nail the shot it's absolutely amazing. And for a few of the shots I also used the Lens Baby, in this case the Sweet 35 on the Composer. And I can't recommend those highly enough. If you're a little bit like stuck with creativity, try one of those Lens Babies. The Composer is something that I love to use because you just have the Composer and the modules are really small. So when you travel, you just take that Composer with you and some modules. It takes less room than one normal lens and you have 4-5 options, whatever you want to put in there. So that was set number one. Let's see the results. Lois went all out. I don't know what she was thinking, but it's absolutely amazing. I just love the makeup on her side. She made like a little bit of a wound, some blood from her eye. It looked absolutely horrendous, but when you put everything together with the lighting, you get something really, really creepy. So Lois, that was absolutely awesome. And the thing is, with these kinds of setups, you can use a very, very simple trick. And I'm actually thinking, should I tell you guys this? Because you know it's the vlog, so we never go really in-depth. Normally we leave that for the commercial videos, but let me just tell you this very, very simple trick. So, when you do color balance, you use a color checker, right? We use the X-Rite color checkers for that. That color balance actually means that the whole image has a certain color, right? Okay. So we're using one gel on the side on Lois, the red gel, and normal lighting on the other side of Lois. So you might expect that one side will be red, the other side will be normal lighting. And it is. However, if you change your color balance just a little bit, then you will get this really freaky look where one side is still a little bit red and the other side actually turns blue. So that was one of the tips that we normally also share in the commercial videos. And that is a little bit more advanced. So during the vlog, I just tell you what we did. But these kinds of tips you can also find on our videos and on the new video actually on Kelby 1. And that was also with Lois. We went outside and we did it with a green gel. Now when you use a green gel outside and you balance on that green gel, the model will look normal, but the sky will turn magenta. Gives you a beautiful, beautiful look. So check that out on our newest video on Kelby 1. And of course, check out our instructional videos in the link below, because those go way more in depth than you see in the vlog. Although this tip just, let me put it this way, this was a freebie for you guys.
Make up your mind.
to. We used a chair in front of, well, our wall with wallpaper. Now, in all honesty, I wanted to shoot this full body, full length, and somehow the images just didn't work for me. So I ended up with close-up. Lighting here is actually a little bit more advanced. We're using one light with a gel on the back. We're using one light with a snoot on our model, and we're using a strip light from the side, from the other side, actually on our model. The reason we're using that strip light is because smoke only registers, well, it registers better when you backlight it. So that's why actually we added that little strip light on the side. And in the strip light, you can probably see that in the video, we're using the Light Tools gray grids. Now, if you don't know about the Light Tools gray grids, make sure you check them out online. I will leave the link below. Those grids are absolutely amazing because normally a grid is black, as you know. But with black, you take away a little bit of light. And sometimes when you have a real narrow grid, you can see some, I call it shimmering. I don't know the exact term for it, but you can see something in the image where you go like, that isn't really cool. Now, when you have grids that are like this, that's not really a problem. But when they get smaller, you get that effect. With a gray grid, what actually happens is the light blends together. So it still steers that light, but you get more light output and you don't have that effect. Now, if you never saw the effect, don't worry. It's only with very, very narrow grids. The light output issue, that's also, of course, with the bigger grids. So I highly recommend checking them out. Light Tools are not the cheapest grids on the market, but in the end, you will save so much money because these grids will literally last your lifetime. And any other grids I tried, they're great, but after about a year or 2 years, they start to hang. And I don't like that. I want grids that after 10 years are still very, very solid. And we recently, well, tried some grids and, well, not the quality of Light Tools. So we ran back to Light Tools and highly recommend them. And especially the gray one. Check it out. Link below. Final setup, and I really, really love these images. They, I don't know what they remind me of, but like old paintings, a little bit like those prayer cards, and it just looks amazing. Lois came in, she had this dress on and a little bit of material over her head, and I was just going like, oh, this looks almost ethereal or heavenly. So we opted for our Lustolite panoramic backdrop, and the cool thing about this one is, because we're now actually having a lighter backdrop in, is that you can put strobes behind it. So we put a red gel behind her and just blasted that backdrop from the back. We didn't even use smoke and overexposed the shot like crazy. So it's more like a high key shot than a normal shot. It's like, I believe, 2.5 stops overexposed, so almost towards white. There's still detail, but it's almost towards white. And let's be honest, I just love the outcome. Combined it with the lens baby I used, and you get that really nice shadow, sharpness fall off. And, well, it just looks amazing. And let's not talk about this longer. We use one strip light from the top, again with that Light Tools grid, one gelled from the back behind the Lustolite, as you saw in the video. Let's just show you the results. Okay, guys, that was it for today. I hope you enjoyed today's episode of Behind the Closed Doors. Next week, I'm taking a week off. Yes, we do workshops, but the rest of the week will be quiet from my side because I have a lot of software to test. We have the new Exposure 5. We are testing the new Topaz. We're testing something for Luminar. We're doing a review and write-up of the new X-Rite products. And of course, the Sony a7R IV. So I think I'm pretty busy next week, although it's my week off, but hey, we love what we do. If you have any questions, if you want me to test certain things on the a7R IV, let me know, because we are totally checking that camera out. It's, at this point, it's already amazing. So it's 60 megapixels. We tried to buffer and there were literally some people almost fainting in the studio. Like, are you really shooting raw, Frank? Really? Is it a, how? Because it was just fast. Let me put it this way. For 60 megapixels, it's just insane what Sony has done. It's faster than the A7R III, it feels. So, and the display, I'm not going to tell you. I'm going to write a review about it, but I'm very, very enthusiastic about it. This is the kind of camera where, let me put it this way, you don't go out and maybe buy it. This is the kind of upgrade where you run out to the store and get it. If you're into that high megapixel count and you just want a great studio camera. And it also performs great on the street, probably. We're gonna test that next week. Okay, guys, leave comments below. Smash that like button, because we really like it. But most of all, tell other people about our channel so we can grow. Thank you so very much for watching. See you next time. Bye-bye.